Okay, I'll keep that open. And we will begin with introductions and get moving. So hello, everybody, and welcome to class today. We are so excited for today's class. My name is Kari Sautner. I'm the Chief Learning Officer at the National Constitution Center, and I'm really excited about today's class. First of all, it's my favorite topic. We get to talk about the civil rights movement. And second, we get to talk to one of our favorite professors. We have a running joke at the Constitution Center that we do not have any favorite professors, but if we did, you would be at the top of the list. So Professor Jeffries, welcome to our class. Thank you so much for coming back, and we are so happy to have you today.
It's great to be with you.
So as we dive into this, I'm going to give the students, as Jeff comes in, I'm going to give the students a little bit of background about you. And because your resume is amazing, and it's also so well-rounded. So I want to make sure that our students know all the work you do and all the ways that they can find you. So number one, you've worked with museums. You've worked with the National Museum of Civil Rights. As you've worked with Montpelier, Madison's home, but Teaching Hard History podcast is also an amazing teaching tool and a fantastic one for educators to use if they're not always already using it. Yeah. But your day job is absolutely a professor of history at Ohio State University. So many angles and so many things that you do. And you're also a writer, and Bloody Lowndes is a fantastic book. I encourage everybody to check it out. And there's a Park Service site about the community that is in, that our team went to from the National Constitution Center. And because of your book, we were able to really engage with the content there and the amazing park rangers that were there. I'll really give them full credit. So thank you so much for really dabbling in every realm of the teaching tools. And without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Jeff Rosen, who's our president and CEO and is going to lead us through this conversation today.
Thank you so much, Curry, and welcome back, Professor Jeffries. It's so great to see you again.
Thank you very much. I always appreciate the invitation and the chance to dialogue with you.
Well, we're always honored to have you, and it's hard to think of a better occasion than celebrating Martin Luther King Day and week. And what we'd love to do is talk about the heroes that you discuss in your important book about the civil rights movement. In understanding and teaching the civil rights movement, you highlight a group of figures, some familiar and some less so, including Marcus Garvey and Ella Baker and Charles Hamilton Houston and Rosa Parks and Diane Nash and, of course, Malcolm X. And I thought we would just go in order and ask you about each of them, and you can share with us their central contribution. So let's begin with Marcus Garvey. Tell us about his contribution to the roots of the civil rights movement.
Well, Marcus Garvey, of course, was an early 20th century African-American activist. He was the founder and president of the UNIA, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, which was active in the late 19-teens, early 1920s. And in fact, we often think about the NAACP as the premier civil rights organization in the early 20th century, starting in 1909. But in 1920, the UNIA, Marcus Garvey's organization, had over 1 million members, and it was global. It had chapters throughout the United States, but then it also had chapters in the Caribbean and overseas. And Garvey is a fascinating figure. He's originally from Jamaica, but settles in New York City and in Harlem and builds up the Universal Negro Improvement Association. And he's advocating for this idea of Black nationalism, this notion that in order for African Americans to thrive and survive, that it's necessary for them to come together, for them to organize together, to build not just political strength, but most importantly, to build economic strength. And he develops a number of Black businesses under the umbrella of the UNIA, as well as really emphasizes positive race consciousness. And why I think it's so important to talk about Garvey, not only because of the organization building that he does, but because he really reflects a through line of positive race consciousness. This idea, and you know, we think about the Black Power era later on, and people talk about Black is beautiful. Well, Garvey was talking about Black is beautiful and the importance of Africa and reclaiming Africa 50 years earlier. And so it's important when we think about the civil rights movement of locating these earlier activists on this important continuum of the Black freedom struggle. And one great way to begin is with Marcus Garvey and the Universal Negro Improvement Association.
What a wonderful introduction to Garvey and his crucially important legacy. I do want to ask you about the Declaration of the Rights of the Negro Peoples of the World, which were the principles of the Universal Negro Improvement Association. It's striking how explicitly those principles invoke the Declaration of Independence. Be it known to all men that whereas all men are created equal and entitled to the rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And because of this, we, the duly elected representatives of the Negro people of the world, invoking the aid of the just and almighty God, do declare all men, women, and children of our blood throughout the world free denizens, and do claim them as free citizens of Africa and the motherland of all Negroes. To what degree was that invocation of the Declaration of Independence part of the rhetoric of the movement at this point? Of course, it culminates in King on the Mall, invoking the Declaration as the promissory note of the Constitution. But tell us about Garvey's relationship to the Declaration of Independence.
Well, it was quite common. And as you just illustrated there, the UNIA and Marcus Garvey really take it to a high level. But it was quite common for African Americans to draw on the founding documents, to use the words of the architects of this nation to say, hold on, if you declare these to be these universal principles that apply, then they do in fact need to apply. And we see with the Declaration, and it's wonderful, teachers can access it, the list of principles that the Garveyites articulated in 1920. It's miraculous because you think, okay, this is 1920, and they're talking about access to the ballot box. They're talking about personal protection, ending racial terrorism. They're talking about this idea of the African-American culture and celebrating it and connecting to Africa. 1920, these are things that we would see echoed going forward for the next 50 years and beyond, but they also pick up on what others have been talking about. So if we think about the African-American freedom struggle stretching back into the institution of slavery, David Walker in 1827 in Walker's Appeal doing the same thing. Like, look, this is what you said. Now, the great irony, Jeff, is that we all understand that the when Thomas Jefferson is writing in the Declaration of Independence that all men are created equal, he was not talking about Black folk. He had a very clear idea that this was supposed to be a white man's nation, emphasis on white, emphasis on man. But here's the thing. He used this universal language, right? And as we used to say growing up in Brooklyn, no take backs. You can't take it back. And so you have activists who say, okay, no. Now we've put this in stone, right? We've written it down. We can't change it. And now we're going to apply this new meaning to it. And we're going to force you. We're going to compel you. We're going to insist that you live up to the higher ideal than even the framers and founders had instilled in it at the time.
No take backs. How well and memorably put. And you're so right to remind us of Walker's Appeal, 1827. Douglass's What to a Slave is the 4th of July in the 1850s, also invoking the Declaration, Garvey, all the way up to King, that all of these great heroes are holding the founders to their own principles and saying you must make the promise of the Declaration a reality. Let's talk now about Ella Baker and grassroots organizing. Tell us about her.
Oh, Ella Baker. If there is one in my classes where I teach at Ohio State on the civil rights movement, on the first day, I say, listen, if there's one person that you remember from this class, it has to be Ella Baker. Ella Baker is a veteran activist, a lifelong activist. She grows up in the Tidewater of Virginia and North Carolina. She will attend Shaw University, a historically Black college in Raleigh, and then graduates in the late 1920s, and then spends the 1930s in New York City, really just learning, right? This is during the Depression. She works for the New Deal agencies and organizations. But then in the 1940s, she becomes the director of branches for the NAACP. Now, this is the 1940s, and she shepherds the NAACP from an organization of about 50,000 members at the start of World War I to an organization of 450,000 members at the start of World War II. To 450,000 members at the end of World War II in a 6 or 7 year period. And it's amazing and remarkable. And she really, starting in the 1940s, now this is critical, you're like, what does the 1940s have to do with the 1960s? because she is making these connections between local people and local activists in the 1940s, that in the 1950s, when Martin Luther King becomes active in the movement, she becomes the interim, because she was a woman, she couldn't get the interim title removed, executive secretary for King's organization. And she's connecting King to all of these activists that she's known for 20 years. And then in the 1960s, she serves as the primary adult advisor for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. So SNCC becomes this frontline organization of the movement in the South. And they bring with them the grassroots understanding, this democracy from the bottom up, empower people, give people light, and let them lead the way was her mantra. She instills that in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and they go on to transform the South. They're the shock troops of the Southern Civil Rights Movement, and it has everything to do with this woman who grew up in North Carolina, who had this vision for empowerment that she inherited from her mother, who was active in the church, and her grandparents, who were born with one foot in slavery and one foot out of slavery. I mean, she is a force. You can't understand the civil rights movement and the connections between organizations and local people and the democratic principles that really were its foundation without understanding Ella Baker, Miss Baker, as her juniors called her.
Wow. Give people light and let them lead the way. That is so inspiring. Thank you so much for telling us about Miss Baker. You mentioned that her mother was in the church. To what degree were the principles of the church central to Ella Baker and to the movement at this time?
So often when we think about the role of the African-American church in the civil rights movement, we focus only on the pulpit. Who was in the pulpit? The preacher in the pulpit. And most often when we're thinking about the Baptist church or the African Methodist Episcopal church, those were usually at the time men. And they played an important role. I mean, Martin Luther King, Fred Shuttlesworth, they are important preachers and ministers in the movement. But Ella Baker's mother was not a preacher. She was very much a part of the church missionary movement, the benevolent societies. The women, if we turn that camera around a little bit and focus not just on the pulpit, but on the pews. When you look at the pews, that's where you find the Black women. That's where you find the sisters. And they're the ones who are in the community, bringing people together, making sure people have what they need. And so Ella Baker learns from her mother that community is important, that it is essential that we understand and connect with the least of us, because they are still us too. And so she takes that spirit, that missionary spirit, that benevolent society spirit, not being a missionary, but this idea of moving into the community and making the community whole. She takes that into the civil rights movement. And so when we think about the church, yes, it's okay to focus on the preachers, but we got to understand who was in the pews and what were they doing and the spirit that they bring into the movement as well.
Wow, focus not just on the pulpit, but the pews, beautiful. All right, we now turn to one of the great figures in constitutional history, a central influence on the Supreme Court's decision in Brown v. Board of Education, Charles Hamilton Houston.
Charles Hamilton Houston. There is no Brown decision without Charles Hamilton Houston. There is no Thurgood Marshall, who will argue Brown and who will become the first African-American Supreme Court justice, without Charles Hamilton Houston. Charles Hamilton Houston is an African-American born and raised in the Washington, D.C. area at the turn of the 20th century. He will be a World War I veteran. And it's very interesting because Charles Hamilton Houston was like, look, he turns to his dad, you know, as the war, World War I is approaching. And he's like, look, I don't want to just be sent over there. Right. It's like, if I got to go, I want to go over in a position of authority. And so he actually becomes an officer and enters into what we would know now as sort of the legal profession within the military. And while he is serving essentially as a lawyer within the military, as a young officer, and one of the very few Black officers at the time, he's looking at this and he's like, the military is segregated. The Black soldiers are facing racism and discrimination. Don't even want to fight, aren't even being allowed to fight on the front lines for the American Expeditionary Force, are being forced to fight with the French, alongside the French, and fight with distinction. And when he leaves, or comes home after World War I, he makes a commitment. He says, I'm going to use the law to fight discrimination and racism. And so a graduate of Amherst College in Massachusetts, he winds up going to Harvard Law School, gets a law degree from Harvard, a master's in law as well from Harvard, and then winds up in DC and becomes the dean of Howard University Law School and transforms Howard University Law School into this incubator for Black lawyers. And this is important because the lawyers, there were so few Black lawyers in America at the time. And he says, no, we're going to make these lawyers, we're going to train these lawyers, and they're going to be constitutional scholars. They're going to use the Constitution specifically to fight for the rights of civil rights activists, for the rights of African Americans. And he used to have this saying. He said, you're either, as a lawyer, as a Black lawyer, he said, you're either a social engineer or you're a parasite. Now, now what did he mean by that? This idea of a social engineer, you're going to use the law to bring about equality in American society, or you're just going to be living off of the few pennies that Black folk make. And he said, we don't have time for that. He said, we need social engineers. We need people who are going to be committed to using the Constitution to transform America. And through this the cadre of lawyers that he inspires and that he trains at Howard University, including Thurgood Marshall, we see starting in the 1930s, and it takes 20 years, them developing the legal precedents that would eventually culminate in the Supreme Court's 1954 Brown decision, but it's a 20-year process. And he started at Howard. He would lead it at the NAACP with the Legal Defense Fund as its first director, and then he hands it off to Thurgood Marshall, who would carry the baton across the finish line in 1954. Unfortunately, he dies before the Brown decision is handed down, but it is solely on his shoulders. The fact that it is the strategy behind it and the fact that we even get to that point in 1954.
Wow, that is so inspiring to learn about the legacy of Charles Hamilton Houston, the founding dean of Howard Law School. Professor Jeffries, I'm in Washington, D.C. right now, and I'm looking out my window and I can see Howard Law School. I'm turning the camera, won't really show it to you, but over those beautiful trees, there's a castle which is towering above Rock Creek, and that is Howard, and that's part of Charles Hamilton Houston's legacy. So inspiring to be here and to feel the meaning of the light he spread. Tell us what his contribution was to the strategy that led to the overturning of Brown. Thurgood Marshall famously took things incrementally. He started off by challenging segregation in swimming pools and law schools, knowing that the most controversial segregation was in public schools, because lots of people were used to that, and he wanted to take things slowly. What was Charles Hamilton Houston's contribution to that strategy?
Well, there was a debate among this cadre of legal scholars, because they knew that they had to get rid of Plessy. And Plessy versus Ferguson, 1896, essentially Supreme Court saying that segregation is constitutional as long as you have equality, right? Separate but equal. And of course, there would never be separate, but it wasn't designed. Jim Crow wasn't designed to create equality. It was designed to reinforce inequality. But here was the thing: in the 1930s, they knew that if they took a direct challenge, and Charles Hamilton Houston is leading this way, this is the debate. If they took a direct challenge to the Supreme Court, or tried to challenge directly Plessy versus Ferguson to the Supreme Court in 1930s, that they would lose. That the court, there was no guarantee even in the future that they would be able to win, but they knew in the 1930s that they had to establish some precedent. The court was not on their side at all. So they said, okay, let's see if we can force these Southern states to live up to what they say they're doing, right? Let's put some teeth behind Plessy versus Ferguson, separate but equal. If you say you're gonna have separate things and they're gonna be equal, then actually let's make them equal. And they knew Thurgood Marshall, Charles Hamilton, they knew there was no way the South could actually afford to equalize things. They couldn't create two equal sets of law schools to train white students and Black students, two equal sets of medical schools, two equal sets of colleges. They knew it was impossible. They couldn't pay everyone in the same way as and create these sort of equal schools. And so they said, okay, we're gonna force your hand. And so we see slowly, starting in the 1930s, throughout the 1940s, a series of cases focused on higher education. And this was important because they want to create these precedents that you got to equalize. And if you don't equalize, then you have to, if you don't equalize separately, then you have to desegregate. They said, let's create these precedents and then challenge at the elementary school level, because they said, we don't want to get all these white parents all worried and organizing against us too early before we have the precedents, knowing that if we focus on higher education, that wouldn't quite generate the stir because you don't have that same emotional attachment that you would have parents who supported segregation would have with the elementary school grades. And so the NAACP wasn't all fully on board, right? Because they were like, look, we refuse to embrace segregation in any way, shape, or form. But Houston said, no, we have to take this legal strategy. And it took a while. It was incremental, but they established the precedents. And then finally, by 1954, when you have the Warren Court, really the beginnings of the Warren Court, you get that a favorable ruling in Brown. But that strategy is really mapped out by Charles Hamilton Houston.
Beautiful. So inspiring. Thank you for that. David Olson notes that just recently, the governor of Louisiana pardoned Homer Plessy, and he had been charged with violating the state separate car act. And he was, as the governor signed the pardon, he said he had a more ambitious aim, confronting a painful and shameful history that the Plessy case came to represent. What do you make of the pardon, and what should we as students of the Constitution make of it?
Well, I think two things. One, we got to understand that when Homer Plessy, who was an African-American, but phenotypically, facially looked as though he was white. He had the family coming out of the Caribbean, a French ancestry in the Caribbean. But when he is arrested for violating the Separate Car Act in New Orleans, that wasn't an accident. Homer Plessy was an activist, and he had set this up. Him as another organization, civil rights activists in Louisiana, set this up because they wanted to challenge this segregation law. And in fact, the railroad company was in agreement with Homer Plessy, saying, yeah, because we don't want to have to pay the cost of having these separate accommodations. And so it's an interesting context that even puts Homer Plessy in this historical moment. But the pardon is important because it is a recognition that the law never should have been passed by the state legislature in the first place, that it was unjust, that it was unconstitutional, that it was unfair. And it is important to have these moments of reflection. And look, it's not gonna obviously change his life. You know, the pardon isn't gonna lift anybody out of poverty, but it is critically important symbolically, as a modest symbolic gesture, to say, you know what? We're not gonna turn away from the past. We are gonna look at the hard history of the past. We're gonna confront it directly. And then we're gonna do in this way, admit that we were wrong as a state, as a community, that we were wrong, and that we will do better going forward.
Wonderful. Thank you very much for that. And thank you, Niels Nielsen, for noting that Ruth Bader Ginsburg copied Charles Hamilton Houston and Thurgood Marshall's legal strategy for the equality of the sexes. Both efforts were so brilliantly orchestrated. Absolutely. Let's turn next to Rosa Parks and the Montgomery bus boycott.
Rosa Parks, you know, Rosa Parks is one of those historical figures that in our K through 12 curriculums, in most schools, most curriculums, most state standards and the like, we're asked to teach Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King. But we don't get enough Rosa Parks, right? We have Rosa Parks frozen in a moment in time in December of 1965, as she refuses to give up her seat on the on that bus in Montgomery, which then triggers the Montgomery bus boycott. But Rosa Parks is you know, early 1940s. Rosa Parks is younger than me. I just had a birthday. I just turned 49. I'm older than Rosa Parks was, right? And so we think about Rosa Parks as this old, you know, tired woman who refused to give up. And she was a 42-year-old activist, veteran activist, 20 years. She had been active fighting and beginning with the Scottsboro Boys and serving as a committee working on a committee to get them free. Nine young men who were falsely charged with rape and arrested and facing the death penalty in the early 1930s. In the 1940s, she becomes the secretary for the NAACP, working to find justice for those Black women who had been the victims of police violence, those Black women who had been the victims of mob violence and sexual violence. And so when we talk about Rosa Parks, it's critically important to talk about that early history, right? She wasn't just a tired seamstress. She was an activist who was tired of racial discrimination. And literally, she would speak about this later on. Like people say, well, what were you thinking at that moment when you refused to give up your seat on this bus? You know, she said, you know what she said she was thinking about? She was thinking about Emmett Till. She was thinking about this 14-year-old boy, Emmett Till from Chicago, who had just been lynched a few months earlier in August. And just a few days earlier, the white men who had killed him were acquitted by an all-white jury. And she said, that was on my mind when I refused to give up that seat. And she was also thinking about and channeling all those earlier activists who had come before her, Addie B. Wells and the like. And she said, those are the people who were looking over my shoulder when I refused to give up. So Rosa Parks is not an accidental activist, right? I mean, she is a career activist. And then after that moment, right? So we can use that Montgomery bus boycott as a point of entry to talk about Rosa Parks, but let's not stop talking about her then. She eventually has to leave Montgomery, Alabama, is really literally run out of town. Her and her husband are unable to find work. She settles in Detroit, Michigan, and then has a hard time finding a stable work there as well. But then eventually she'd work in the office of Congressman John Conyers, and she would then go on for another four decades of activism. Right. I mean, so this is a person, I mean, working for housing equality, working for ending housing discrimination in Detroit and elsewhere. And so that's an important part of the story. So here is a person who is not an accidental activist, is central to this particular moment in time, but it's because she had been preparing to create change her entire life. And I think it's important that we understand what it means to be a lifelong activist. And that our students understand that these were ordinary people in these unusual, extraordinary circumstances, but they were up to the challenge because they had been thinking about this and have been committed to creating change their entire lives.
Wow, it is crucially important to understand the historic figures who inspired her. As you just said, Emmett Till, Ida B. Wells, not an accidental activist, but a lifelong activist because she was inspired by these other heroes. And that's why it's so urgently important to study this history exactly as we're doing now. And thank you for teaching it to us. We have two other great figures to cover during this class. And that's Diane Nash and the Freedom Rides is next.
Yeah, Diane Nash. So I especially like Diane Nash, who is a young woman, a college student in 1960 from Chicago, heads down to spends a year at Howard University, but then winds up transferring and heading down to Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee. Young woman, right? And has spent most of her life in Chicago, Illinois, outside the South, and understands discrimination, but sees it in a different way when she heads south, right? And sees the Jim Crow signs and sees the Jim Crow culture. And she says, you know what, this has to be something that we can do. And she finds her way into these nonviolent training workshops led by Reverend James Lawson, a committed pacifist, a committed nonviolent activist, just a few years older than them. And he is holding these nonviolent workshops and training young people in the Black colleges in Nashville, Tennessee, to engage in nonviolent direct action. And the people who would be in that class, in those workshops, in the basement of a church in Nashville, include not only Diane Nash, but John Lewis, Bernard Lafayette, James Bevel. I mean, these are young, 17, 18, 19 years old at the time. And then in 1960, in February 1, 1960, when the four young men in North Carolina and in Greensboro, North Carolina, begin the sit-ins, this is what the Nashville students have been preparing for. And so while Greensboro marks the first sit-ins at a large scale that really garner the national attention, it's the Nashville students who are the most prepared to execute the sit-ins and bring about fundamental change. And so it's Diane Nash who serves as like the spokesperson for the Nashville movement. And from then they move from the sit-ins, moving into the formation of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in the fall. And ironically, the person who becomes the essentially the head of SNCC early on, the person that people look to, because the student activists are like, man, Nashville, those are the students who are on the move, right? And they say, well, who's leading Nashville? And they turn to the brothers. And so Marion Barry becomes the first, essentially what would become, we would consider the president of SNCC. But it should have been Diane Nash, right? And had she not been a woman, and we got to understand the gender dynamics. Like, she would literally have been and should have been that first, that first head of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. But it didn't matter to her. Like, titles didn't matter. And so when we fast forward into 1961 and the Congress of Racial Equality begins the Freedom Rides, these activists, integrated groups of activists, Black and white, who are going to ride public interstate transportation, trailways and Greyhound buses from Northern, starting in Washington, D.C., not too far from where you are, and going to ride these buses into the South to test compliance with desegregation mandates by the federal government, saying you have to desegregate interstate travel and commerce. And when they meet violence, first in North Carolina, first in South Carolina, and then are met with violence in Birmingham, Alabama, with the burning of the Trailways bus and being beaten badly in Birmingham, North Carolina. Those early Birmingham, Alabama, that group of activists, like, look, all right, we've seen enough, right? Like, we're about to bail, we're out of here. But it's the young activists led by Diane Nash who say, you can never let violence stop the movement. And so they come together, write letters, literally writing their last will and testament, and say, we will pick up where those early freedom riders left off. And they send a group down into Birmingham, Alabama. Now, Diane Nash doesn't go. Diane Nash picks the short straw and is told to sort of remain behind because they have to keep that communication. But she's the one who's really moving people in and out and communicating with the federal government. And Robert F. Kennedy says, who the heck is Diane Nash? Who's this young woman who's telling us what we can and cannot do and won't call this stuff off? And so Diane Nash plays this pivotal role in the Freedom Rides, which really draws the federal government, the Kennedy administration, into the movement on the side of African-American activists. And then she would spend a considerable amount of time organizing in Mississippi. And so organizing African-American voters in Mississippi, spending time in prison while she was pregnant. I mean, amazing. And then serves as an organizer for the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, helping to organize the Selma voting rights campaign. And then, of course, none of these activists just stop, right? And so she continues to lead a life of activism and is still alive today. A number of interviews and oral histories have been done with her that teachers can find online, including with Eyes on the Prize, which are available at Washington University. I mean, a fascinating figure. And for young people, just a really wonderful person who they should know because they will see themselves in her.
That is incredible. It's wonderful that she's still alive. It's so meaningful to think about the possibility of still interviewing her. Who are the other, of course, we just lost John Lewis. Who are the other great heroes of the civil rights movement who are still alive?
There's still a lot of them. And I'm like, well, what's in the water that y'all were drinking? I mean, a number of SNCC activists, Judy Richardson, Cortland Cox, Gloria Richardson is still around. I mean, there's an amazing number. I mean, these, and they're not just still around. They're still engaged in activism. They're still engaged in communication and working with young people. And this is 50 years after. I mean, you know, I get students who come into my office and they're like, Dr. Jeffries, we're going to lead this movement. Like, okay, go ahead. They go out and they have a march and demonstration and they come back like, Dr. Jeffries, we're tired. I'm like, even in this 2 weeks, right? You have people who've been doing this for 50 years and it's just amazing. And there's also, of course, generations of activists. So you have those who were active in the 60s, but then those who came up under them during the Black Power era. And so it's critical, and the names that won't be familiar to many people outside of their communities. I mean, so it's always a wonderful assignment for any school to look for the people who were active in movements locally. Because a lot of times, Jeff, people who were leading movements won't even self-identify as activists. And it's only once you start talking to them or look at the historical record and say, hey, you were involved in this effort to desegregate the school. You were involved in this effort to bring about the ballot, to put the ballot in African American in the hands of African Americans. I mean, it is just simply amazing the number of people who are still here and who are still active.
That is incredible. I would love to talk with you and Curry about perhaps reaching out to some of these heroes, Judy Richardson, Cortland Cox, Gloria Richardson, Diane Nash, and trying at least on Zoom to be able to talk to them and get their brilliant light and share them with our students. That would be completely amazing. Let us conclude very reluctantly, because it's always such, so the time with you is always so special and we learn so much, with Malcolm X. You remind us that understanding him and his role in the civil rights movement requires understanding many distinct phases of his life, but you talk in particular about that moment in February 65 when he accepted an invitation by SNCC organizers to speak in Selma. His message was simple: white officials better negotiate with King and those who practice nonviolence as a way of life, or else they'd have to deal with him and those who embraced the right to bear arms. Tell us about Malcolm X and his legacy and his relationship with King.
Well, in a way, we do the same thing with Malcolm X that we do with Martin Luther King. We freeze King in a moment in time. We did this with Rosa Parks. We freeze King on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, dreaming about colorblindness. And we don't put that speech into context. And we certainly don't look at his evolution as a thinker, as an activist, as a social critic at all. And we do the same thing with Malcolm X. We tend to freeze him in a moment in time. And Malcolm X is a wonderful case study of the evolution of a political thinker. And I like to think of Malcolm X almost, and teach him, when I teach him really in sort of four phases connected to the names that he identifies as, right? So he's born Malcolm Little in Omaha, Nebraska. But then by the time we get to the 1940s, and his parents are Garveyites. Ah, going back to Marcus Garvey. Malcolm X comes up in a Garveyite home, learning about race first, this idea of race first and Black nationalism, right? And Black is beautiful. Then, of course, his father is tragically murdered by at the hands of parties unknown. His mother really suffers a sort of a nervous breakdown and is committed. And so then he winds up being pulled out of his home. And then we see this period in which he is just lost, right? I mean, he's on the streets, he's trying to survive. And he changes his name. I mean, he takes the street name of Detroit Red, and he's a hustler, a two-bit hustler, right? But he's a hustler nonetheless, moving far away from those Garveyite roots. But then while he's in prison, he has this religious conversion, embraces the Nation of Islam, and then becomes an activist, right? And so he comes out while in prison, he changes his name to Malcolm, and then gets that X. And so there's this third phase of Malcolm X. And this we see in the 1950s and the early 1960s. And this is the fierce Malcolm X, right, who speaks truth to power and is critical of and offering a critique, not only of a sort of racism in the South, Jim Crow, but he's like, we got to deal with racism outside the South. He famously says that, the South, if you are African-American, the South is not what's below the Mason-Dixon line. The South is anywhere below the Canadian border. And what he meant by that is that racism wasn't regional. Racism was national. And so he's really strident. But now, this is also the deeply religious phase of Malcolm. And so he has a religious critique of white people, right? This is where, some teachers say, oh, you talk about white people, the devil's out. That was the religion, man. But you got to understand that it was just a critique, right? It was the social critique. And they were using religion to offer this critique. And he wasn't speaking to white people. He was speaking to Black folk. Right. And they were trying to get Black folk to understand particularly the power of economics, very Garveyite, and building institutions. And then the final phase of Malcolm. And this is an important phase, because in that Malcolm X phase, he is very critical of civil rights activists. Right. He's like, what are you doing down there? But once we get to that final phase where Malcolm converts, he leaves the Nation of Islam and converts to Orthodox Islam, he takes on a different appreciation. Now, often we think about the appreciation. Well, he appreciated white people differently. Not so much that. What he appreciated differently was African-American activists. And he looks to Dr. King. He's like, man, he's like, you know what? I talked a lot about the problem, but you did a lot about the problem. That's why we see him in Selma, Alabama, a couple of weeks before he's assassinated, because he is there to support the voting rights drive that was down there. When he was in the nation's policy was don't participate in electoral politics, which frustrated Malcolm. And so once he's free of the nation and he's down in Selma, Alabama, he's like, look, we got to support everybody. who is fighting for freedom and justice. And so there is a coming together, if you will, of in terms of the approach to the freedom struggle between Malcolm and Martin as we get to the mid-1960s. But Malcolm always maintains a structural critique of racism. And he is also always skeptical that white people would be willing on their own to change their beliefs and behaviors as it related to white supremacy. And he said the emphasis has to be not just on civil rights, but on human rights, and also changing laws to ensure that behavior doesn't negatively impact people of color.
Amazing. I have so many more questions, but I'm going to resist asking them so we can reconvene. We're getting some encouragement in the chat to reconvene, and there's so much to reconvene about. So Professor Jeffries, I am so grateful to you for shedding so much light and just encouraging all of us to learn more about these inspiring heroes and who've done so much to change the Constitution. Curry, just a couple of final questions from our friends for this amazing lead off to Martin Luther King Day weekend.
Exactly, and that was the whole point. We get Professor Jeffries in here so we can dive in deep and then have a great celebration on Monday and think about all the work that needs to continue to go forward. So one question, and I know a lot of our students are younger in this class today. You spoke about, you know, the civil rights freedom riders are still alive, that there's still civil rights leaders of the 60s that are still alive. That's partly because it was a young movement. So can you talk a little bit about kids the same age as our eighth graders that had a role in the movement and how unbelievably powerful that is?
I think you're absolutely right. Young people were central to the movement. And it was critically important that you had this young energy because these were young people who couldn't vote. And I think the one of the best case studies for this is to look at what happened in Birmingham, Alabama. In Birmingham, Alabama, when you have young people, young Black students in Birmingham, Alabama, who will take to the streets facing the police dogs and the water hoses of Bull Connor, Public Safety Commissioner Bull Connor, and they do not turn back. They do not turn away. They go to jail in Birmingham, Alabama. And you're right, these are kids. These are not just college students. These are not just high school students. These are middle school and elementary school students who said, you know what? I can't vote, but I can draw attention to the problems that are facing my community and this society. And by putting my body out there, by raising my voice, by being visible, I can bring about change in society. And we see that in Birmingham, but we also see it in Selma, Alabama, right? When parents were too afraid, worried about they might lose their jobs to walk down to the county courthouse, it was young people who marched down to the county courthouse. We see it time and time and time again, that the energy that young people inject into civil rights organizing transforms the movement. We saw that just 2 years ago in following the murder of George Floyd, where you have 30 plus million people, mostly young people, led by young people, taking to the streets in the summer, in the middle of a pandemic, to raise, demanding justice for the victims of police violence. Now that is a continuation of that energy that we saw coming out of the 1960s and the civil rights movement.
And I have to say there's 8 million questions in there for you. So we have to get you back soon and not wait like a whole 6 months to get you back here. But just one final kind of note and questions from the group. You've talked about this a few times, and I just heard you on NPR like last week talking about this, that their change does take time. And Neil's asked a question about what is the civil rights energy of today that we should be focused on. But you also break it out between optimism and hope. And it's a really kind of thoughtful way to think about how it does. These people are putting their minds, their bodies, their lives, their families all in the line. It's not easy. And it's past optimism and positivity. It takes time, effort, energy, and sometimes not seen in your life. So can you break down what is the modern discussion around this? And then what is that balance between change, optimism, and hope?
Well, I mean, you really just laid it out so wonderfully, right? I mean, the idea, when you think about, there are obstacles, there have always been obstacles. Change does not happen simply by the passage of time. Often we think that time is a social force and that if you just let time pass, and King writes about this in the letter from Birmingham Jail, if you just let time pass, change will occur. But time is not a social force capable of creating change. You need people engaged in activism, taking up acts itself, in order to bring about the change that you need. And that to me, even when that change is slow, even when it's incremental, even when things go backwards and get worse, right? We got to get away from this idea of perpetual progress, this myth of American perpetual progress, that things always get better. No, things get worse more often than they get better. We have these small increments of really progressive, positive change. A lot of times it's just flatlining, and most of the time things are going backwards. But one constant has been a willingness on the part of people, certainly among African Americans, but even among the broader public and a number of allies, not everybody, but some allies, right? The one constant has, there have always been people who have been willing to fight and sacrifice. There have always been people who said, I have to do something. And that to me is where the hope is. I'm not always optimistic when you survey the political terrain that things are gonna get, are gonna change positively in the immediate or short-term period. I mean, we have to be realistic. But I know, because of the study of history, that there are always going to be people who are willing to fight. And as long as you have people who are willing to organize, people willing to sacrifice, you will have change. It may not be the full change that you want. It may not come as quick as you want. But in its absence, nothing happens. But because we know that we've seen it in the past, for centuries, that's how we have made progress in this nation. That gives me the hope. That tells me that we will continue to have it in the present. We saw that, and we continue to see it over the last few years, and that will lead us into the future. That's how we get towards that more perfect union.
And I think that is a perfect way to go into MLK Day, to go into our lives, to study history, to find the patterns and see the effort that goes into that change, and then take it upon ourselves to make change. It doesn't happen without us. So thank you so much, Professor Jeffries. As always, you're so inspiring. Such a great storyteller, and we just love having you on. So we'll be bugging you soon enough. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Professor Jeffries.
Thanks so much.
So inspiring. Thanks to all. Have a great weekend. Thank you.
Okay.
Bye.